Hello. The old friend sends you Drozera. A bit unexpected though, so to meet the Australian, the continent which I first time saw Drozera spatulata. They meet an Australian plant here, on just on the road on Okinawa. Well, this species actually grows in all East Asia, so it's not so unexpected. And the old friend, because I've worked with Sandius for some time and even had some publications about it. Sandius are amazing plants and extremely weird. One of my friends have a classification. According to her, all plants are split into groups: Sandius and water lilies. So Sandius is something extremely weird, something strange, like for example African Welwitschia. Whereas water lilies, she actually worked with both. So water lilies is something nice, attractive, like rose or magnolia. So this is Sandius, typically Sandius. So plant which adapted itself to catch insects. Leaf of Sandius are sticky tapes. So they lay on the ground in the wait for some prey. Sometimes, it's not very frequent, but you can see it among plants here. Prey are present on some leaves. Ants, small flies, or some other small animals, because strong animal, strong insect will probably escape from the leaf. So this insect typically come to the leaf in hope to find a flower, because leaves are imitating flowers. In some ways they are, as you see, reddish. However, they do photosynthesis, they have chlorophyll, they are reddish in appearance and have multiple trichomes with kind of nice drop on top. It's a kind of slime or glue. So from a distance it might look attractive for the insect. It will come to the leaf in search for something useful and then will be glued to the leaf forever. Well, it was reported so many times that leaves of Sandius will catch insects. This is not exactly true, it's only partially true. Yes, relatives of Sandius, for example European Aldrovanda or American famous one Dionaea, the Venus flycatcher, I had a chance to observe it myself in native habitat in Carolina swamps. These plants have active catching. They close leaf if something or somebody will touch it. But Sandius employs something very, very ancient. So we are in many different observation experiments. So we simply sat nearby the plants and observed them for many hours in a row, for several days, like without change. So we do it like 48 or even more hours. So people of course change it and observe it condition of each leaf. And what we found, that leaves of Sandius, they do this open and close movements even with the absence of the prey. So looks like leaves are just opening and closing in hope that at some point some prey will be within, and in that case they will start digestion. So kind of strategy: you sit under the tree, open and close your mouth in hope that something will fall down, and then you start to chew. Very, very ancient carnivore strategy, but it works. It works like what? It doesn't work like this is working for animal carnivores. Animal carnivores take the prey for living. They use it to supply their energy resources, not for plants. Plants do photosynthesis. This is a photosynthetic plant. Idea is, look here, it grows on a very bare soil. Only few glycinoid ferns are growing nearby and some grasses. So glycinoid ferns may grow here because they connected with this rhizome to the plants which grow slightly upward. And grasses can survive in some unusual conditions, but definitely this is extremely bad soil, extremely while poor of any nutrients. So Drosera enjoys the growing on these poor soils because of carnivora. So carnivora will supply it not with the food, not with an energy, but with the nitrogen. Nitrogen must go inside the plant to synthesize DNA, for example, and proteins. Without nitrogen, these processes will not go. So photosynthesis is not enough. Plants must obtain nitrogen from somewhere else, from soil. But if soil is poor, okay, then we'll take insects and take nitrogen from them. Insects will be, of course, rotting. Bacteria will do it. And if the plant is speedy enough, it will participate in this rotting process and take nitrogen into the body of the plant. And that will allow plant to make proteins and DNA, very important chemicals for the life. So nitrogen taking plants, so actively taking nitrogen, not exactly carnivorous in a sense like people typically use it. So this is a carnivorous sensio. Interesting is also such a broad geographical distribution. So sensios grow everywhere, almost everywhere in the world, in South Africa and South America, everywhere, and in tropics, in a cold region. So my observations took part in Arctic, but here is almost tropics. So you see, sensio grows everywhere because this poor soil occurs systematically, sporadically, but systematically everywhere. So plant is never frequent here, but you can find it and can enjoy looking of this beautiful carnivora. Another interesting question, which I am unable to show today because sensio is without flowers. Another very interesting question, I just like you to think of it. How to distinguish between prey and pollinators? So many carnivorous plants are insect pollinated. While eating their own customers is a bad habit, right? So think of it. Thank you very much.